Hey everyone, so I did say that every Wednesday I was going to upload a video about diabetes, whether it's a recipe, whether it's something to do with my journey. So today I thought I'd start with my journey. So let's take it back to January 2019. I was on my honeymoon in Mauritius. It was an all-inclusive resort and I don't drink alcohol, but I was drinking a lot of fizzy drinks and a lot of mocktails and of course eating all the food under the sun. All of a sudden, I felt like my feet were like walking on air and they were feeling really tingly, and it was a really strange feeling and I couldn't explain it. I also found that I was going to the toilet a lot more. So in the middle of the night, I would get up like 2-3 times in the night to go to the toilet, and even during the day, I'd have to run off to the toilet. Now, I had really good bladder control before that, so I used to be really good, and I know you shouldn't do this, but I was really good at being able to hold it until I got to a toilet. This was not the case. I like had to rush to the toilet to the point where my brain would see the toilet and be like, come on, you gotta get it out. And I'm kind of like, wait. No, it didn't work. So I couldn't quite figure out what was going on. And when I got back to the UK, I went to see my doctor. He at first just looked at me and was like, I think you're diabetic. And I was like, yeah, okay, fine, whatever. And he's like, no, really. So he rushed through my blood test and my urine test and made me go and do all that really, really fast because he got really worried, especially considering I was only 30 years old. I went for my blood test, I went for my urine test, and it came back that I was diabetic. So straight away, he put me on metformin and algogliptin. I never get the word right, but I think it's called algogliptin. So he rushed me through that and I started taking the medicine straight away. But in my head, I still just thought it's a passing phase. You know, they've got it all wrong. The doctors couldn't quite figure out what was going on. So, and the fact that I was so young. So they kept sending me for more and more blood tests. This went on for a couple of months while I was taking the medication. And it got to May. And in May, we had already planned that we were going to Thailand. It was all booked. So there I was, packing to go on holiday. Normally, the only thing I worry about is making sure I've got my passport with me and of course some clothes. No, this time I had to think about all the tablets to make sure that I had everything with me, made sure I had extra tablets with me. At this time, they also gave me one of the glucose machines, so I had to carry that with me. And it just became a whole new heap of things that I had to remember to pack. So there I go, off arm to Thailand. And when we landed on the first day, I started my glucose machine. I took a little prick test and it was super high. I mean, my diabetes was between 18 and 21 on the glucose level, which anyone who's got diabetes or anyone that knows anything about glucose levels, that was not good, not at all. So at that point in Thailand, it started going down. And I think the reason behind this was we were walking a lot more. I was doing like 10,000 steps nearly a day. I was eating a lot better. The food in Thailand was a lot better. I wasn't eating as much sweet stuff. It was very hot, so I was drinking a lot of water. So obviously I was feeling a lot better as well. And at this point I thought, yes, it's going down. You know, I'm gonna be off these tablets soon. It's fine. Got back to the UK and that was not the case. It shot back up again. The minute I landed and the minute I started eating all that crap and eating all those carbs and eating all those sweet stuff and drinking all that fizzy drinks that I shouldn't have been drinking, it shot back up. At this point, I'm still in denial. I'm still like, there's nothing wrong with me. They sent me for an MRI scan and that came back with, actually, let me tell you about that. That was the scariest thing ever, because I'm claustrophobic and being put into an MRI scan, a full body MRI scan, was horrible. And I thought to myself, I'm not going to be able to cope with this, but they got me in there. I done my MRI scan and it came back that I had fatty liver. So again, who knows what caused this? There was talks about it could be polycystic ovaries, it could be anything. They just didn't have a clue. The doctors did not know. So I started going to see a diabetic consultant instead. And at the same time, I went for my diabetic eye test. That all came back positive. And they were like, your eyes are absolutely fine, which is great. They done other tests, which were all coming back okay. So they were like, the only problem is your glucose levels are still up here. You need to bring them down. The doctor even suggested, now this was my childhood doctor, this was the doctor that I've had since I was a baby. When I went to see him, he said to me, I think you need to go on a vegan diet. My face was like, I don't think so. He was like, no, really, I think you need to go on a vegan diet. I want you to try it. And in my head, I'm thinking, you're mad. You think I'm ever going to go on a vegan diet? It's not going to happen. So I went back home, and by this point, we're now in August. In August, we were going to America on a family trip. That is a big, big disaster for me because America has all the stuff that I love to eat. All those sugary foods that I love are there in America, and I ate them all. And it was so bad for me, but for some reason, I was still in denial. And you're talking about months after I've been diagnosed. I'm taking my medication, but that's about it. Anyway, I got back. And over time, the diabetes levels went down a little bit. They got to about 9-10. And I was kind of like, okay, we're doing okay. I started trying a few different things, and I realized that certain things like not eating as many carbs was bringing down the levels. Maybe cutting out some sugary stuff during the day was, of course, bringing down the levels. But yet, I'm still in denial at this point. January and March this year, I went to America again. I was a lot better with my food this time. I was a lot more conscious of what I was eating, but that didn't mean that I was doing any better with cutting everything out and really eating healthy. It's only when I landed back here in March, I was supposed to have my diabetic consultants again speak to me. I was supposed to go for a second MRI, and I was meant to have my blood tests again, but obviously everything went into lockdown. And I started doing my prick test every morning again, which I'd stopped doing. I'd started doing them like very randomly, like every couple of days. And I was surprised to notice that my levels were literally between 8 and 9. That was it. My weight was like between 10.7 and 10.9, and it kept going up and down and it wasn't moving. And I thought, you know what? I need to do something about this. And at the moment, that is where my journey is at. There is more to this. There is something else that really triggered me thinking I need to do something about this. And I'm going to tell you about that very soon, probably in next week's video. But for now, that is my diabetic journey. That is where I was. That is where I am. And like I said, I was in complete denial. So I will not judge anybody else who says to me, I'm scared to go to the doctors. I don't want to go and check it. Especially if you're as young as I was only 30. If you're like around that age and you're like, you know what, if I've got it, I don't want to know. The only advice I can say is if you think you might be diabetic, please, please, please go and have the test done. At least then you know. I'm not going to say you won't be in denial. I'm not going to say that it's not scary, but at least you will know and you can do something about it. The effects could be even worse if you are diabetic, you're carrying on eating all the sugary stuff, and you're not taking any medicine. It could be a lot worse. So please make sure that if you think you may be diabetic, it doesn't matter what your age, just go and get those tests done and go and speak to your GP so that if you need to take medication, they can get you onto the right stuff. So I just realized that I mentioned two things that people might not actually know what they are. So I thought I would just sort of clarify by reading off my iPad. So fatty liver was one of them. And fatty liver happens when fat builds up in the liver. Having small amounts of fat in your liver is normal, but having too much can become a health problem. Too much fat in your liver can cause liver inflammation, which can damage your liver and create scarring. In severe cases, this scarring can lead to liver failure. When fatty liver develops in someone who drinks a lot of alcohol, it's known as alcoholic fatty liver. And of course, in someone who doesn't drink alcohol, it's known as non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. And apparently, according to research, it affects up to 25 to 30% of the United States and Europe. So I got told that mine's not that bad, it's just a little bit, and it's not really life-threatening at the moment, but of course it's something that they just need to keep an eye on, hence why I have to have another MRI. The other thing I spoke about, which actually got confirmed that I don't have this, and the other thing that I want to talk about is something that actually I got confirmed I don't have this, but it is something that can cause diabetes, and that is polycystic ovaries. And apparently, had I have had polycystic ovaries, I would have had this from quite a while back without actually realizing. Polycystic ovaries contain a large number of harmless follicles that are up to about 8 millimeters in size. The follicles are undeveloped sacs in which eggs develop, and these sacs are often unable to release an egg, which means ovulation does not take place. Now, here are some of the symptoms of polycystic ovaries: irregular periods or no periods at all, difficulty getting pregnant, excess hair growth, so usually around the face, chest, back, and buttocks, weight gain, thinning hair and hair loss from the head, oily skin or acne. So I had a few of these. I get a lot of hair loss. My hair's become very thin over the years. I have irregular periods, so that was another. I have irregular periods, hence another reason why they thought I may have polycystic ovaries, and I do get oily skin. But apart from that, I didn't have any of the other symptoms, and it, like I said, turned out that I didn't have polycystic ovaries. But I just thought I'd put that in there for you guys, for anyone watching this that might think, actually, I have that, let me go and talk to my doctor. So like I said, I urge you to please go and talk to your doctor if you have any symptoms, just because you just never know what it could be.